This is the one that they've been asking for. It really is.
Yep, Mr. Football himself, Mr. Glenn Hoddle.
Fantastic to be here. Good fun. Looking forward to it.
I'm a young player coming to England, and I'm ringing my mates at home going, guys, and they're going, who's the best player? Guys, the manager.
The gaffer.
The manager's the best player in training. It's crazy. And he was doing things like kicking the ball. And I've asked you this before. He used to kick the ball and make noises. I just think this guy, he's seeing the ball and the game different. A lot of the people that we see in the comments want to know about England and when you managed England as well.
The one thing I will do is I'm going to fill that midfield up. That's where I think you win and lose games, particularly in international football. People ask me who's the best player I've coached, and it's Paul Scholes, Matt Letizia. Incredible skills, fantastic for Southampton. And people just say, why didn't you play him more for England? And I used to go, Paul Scholes. Well, it's 3 years now. I had a cardiac arrest in BT Studios. And if it wasn't for Simon Daniels, the engineer there, sound engineer, I wouldn't be sitting here now. I'd be gone, because he kept me alive for a long time. I'd gone for 7 minutes, and he did CPR on me.
Sokin. They can never do it like I. When you see man pull up and slide, man stepped in a room with legends, Rio and Steve, you know it's a vibe. Check the podcast, what you wanna know? Don't ask me, go and ask Joe. If you're talking Premier League, he's on the front line and I gotta go. Oh. It's a vibe with five, and you already know what it is. It's a vibe with five, and you already know what it is. Vibe with five, and you already know what it is. It's a vibe with five, and you already know this.
Listen, Joel, before we get to Rio and Glenn Hoddle joining us, I just want to talk to you a little bit about money goals, right? Mm. And I don't know if you've checked out Sokin. And I don't know if
you don't know if I've checked out Sokin.
I don't know if these lot have checked out Sokin.
Jeez,
you need to go check out Sokin. And it's not just because it's an awesome service, because it is a genuinely awesome service, but they are giving you the chance to win some really good prizes. And also, tickets to Arsenal and City.
Come on then.
But might not be a great price for some people.
What?
If you're a City fan, you might enjoy that. I don't think Arsenal fans are going to enjoy that.
Listen, like, mate, it's a massive
front row
massive
seats
gift
to your own execution, lads.
It's a massive gift, mate. Don't listen to him. All you got to do is make sure you download Sokin app, sokinglobal.com. Check it out.
They've also got Arsenal West Ham tickets, which Arsenal fans, maybe if you get the option, go in that one. And also a United shirt signed by Rio.
Yeah, that's great. But we've got to talk about the Arsenal versus West Ham one, right? Because they get to come to a game with yours truly, right? Yours truly.
Is there a second prize that's not going to be?
That is the main prize. But yeah, make sure you check out Sokin. Much love. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we are back for a special episode of Vibe with Five. Rio, this is the one that they've been asking for. It really is.
Yep, Mr. Football himself, Mr. Glenn Hoddle.
Man, I mean, you put it out there, right? But the fans wanted to see it. Here we go.
Don't, for a minute, can we just forget the fans? I wanted to see it.
Yeah,
I know. Right, I wanted to see it. The amount of times Glenn's name has been dropped on Vibe with Five is actually madness, isn't it? Yeah. So can I just say welcome and thanks for coming on.
It's great to be here, It's fantastic to be here. Good fun, looking forward to it.
Thank you very much, man. Rio, I'll let you kick off because obviously I know you look up to Glenn quite a lot. You sent us a list of questions this morning. These are my questions for Glenn. Yeah. You think you don't work with him.
First time he's done that.
Yeah, I know.
No, you know what? It's just, I think it's great to have Glenn come on the show. Obviously, he was my manager, I'd give him my debut for England. But as a manager, as a player, as a person, I look at him as like Mr. Football, like the gospel of football. And when we get together, we chat, we don't stop talking. You got a book out at the moment?
Yeah, got me
plugged that straight away.
Yeah, autobiography out, which is, it's been enjoyable. I've turned down many a times they've been asked me to do a book and I've said no. And then BT have asked me to do a film as well and that's out as well and it paralleled. And it wasn't planned like that, Ray, but it was just, and I thought, this is a bit too much doing, you know. But in the end, it's worked quite well. And it's been quite, with what happened to me in the studio, you know, with the cardiac arrest, it's been quite therapeutic for me to go back down memory
lane. Can you just explain that to people that might not be aware of that?
Yeah, it's 3 years now. I had a cardiac arrest in BT Studios. And if it wasn't for Simon Daniels, the engineer there, sound engineer, I wouldn't be sitting here now. I'd be gone, because he kept me alive for a long time. I'd gone for 7 minutes and he did CPR on me. The importance of CPR, everyone out there, is right at the top of my list, as you can imagine.
You said today in the studio that all your family have done it now.
Yeah.
Done a course.
Yeah, since then we've done a course because it's so important. You know, it saves people. I'm sitting here and I'm proof that it saves people's lives. And without Simon doing what he did on that day, and without me probably being in the studios at that time, I could have been anywhere. I would have gone, yeah. So to do the book and to do the film was quite tough at times, talking about that and going through that. But I felt ready. 3 years later, I felt ready to talk about it. And it was quite therapeutic. It was all like almost like a self-counselling session, you know, doing it. But
what's that feeling, Glenn? What's that feeling that, can you tell us, I don't want to talk about death really, but that feeling of but that feeling of going, like, has it made you look out on life differently? But also that feeling at the time, do you remember anything?
Well, this is the strangest thing, Rio, about it all. This is what was frightening for me afterwards. I collapse, but I'm doing a live show with BT. You know, I felt okay. I didn't feel, it's like we're all sitting here now. Mm. I didn't feel ill. I didn't look ill.
It was
chatting.
Your birthday as well, wasn't it?
It was on my birthday, yeah, 61st birthday. Wow. And that was the frightening thing, looking back. And then suddenly I have this massive cardiac arrest, which is different to a heart attack. I didn't know that. I always thought they were the same.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, no, not many people do. And you've got 3 minutes. You've got 3 minutes. If they can't get a defibrillator, or the CPR, you're doing the CPR on your heart, then you've got no chance. Thank God that Simon was there. And, you know, I was gone for 7 minutes, he said. My pulse had gone and he just kept me going. And he broke 7 of my ribs, which was great of him. But the nurses tell me in the hospital.
Don't normally say thank you for getting your ribs broken. Yeah.
That's right. Imagine when I saw him afterwards, I had him around my house and I gave him a big hug and he killed me with his ribs again. So, but no, it was... it doesn't matter. He said, you just do your job that you had to do. And he was a volunteer policeman. So he was trained in doing it. But getting back to that question, yeah, it was surreal because, you know, I've had a belief since I was 28 I believe we go on. I don't think it's the end here. I think life is about we go on, a consciousness or whatever you want to, however you want to look at it. But when you're so close to death and you come back and you look, every second is quite incredible. Being here with you guys, every second, every morning I get up, I'm just so thankful. And I look at my family, I look at my grandchildren, and it just, you know, I just want to spend every second, important second, whatever you're doing, it changed me in that way, yeah, without a doubt.
I was watching a documentary as well, and I thought it was incredible when you stepped into the place where it all happened. Oh. Can you talk us through that a little bit, how that was?
That was tough. Mm-hmm. I thought I was ready. In the end, I suppose I was because I got through it, but it was much tougher emotionally. I didn't know. I'd been back so many times, really. Mm-hmm. We'd been working there in the studio where it happened. Mm-hmm. But you know what? I was going back and I was doing a job. So you put your job head on, don't you? You put your professional head on. And I sort of, I knew roughly where it was. But I never went back this time. I went back to see actually where almost X marks the spot sort of thing where it was. And that was very tough. Emotionally, I just, you know, I didn't know how I was going to cope. And it was tough talking about it and looking down. I wanted to get on with it and get it done and get out of the way, if I was really honest. And tried my best to do the interview that I was trying to do. But emotionally, it was very, very difficult, you know. But
talking about coping and just lightening the mood a little bit.
Yeah, it's getting a bit deep. Yeah, now, yeah.
How did
let's take it high.
Yeah, how did you deal with, or how did you cope that night in Amsterdam, Spurs, yes. When we were celebrating, when Spurs won and they went through and I smashed you in the ribs and smashed you all over the place after this
brilliant.
Happened.
It was brilliant because the reaction of me and the reaction of you, he's not even a Spurs fan, and his reaction was brilliant. But our reactions were there, and then it was halfway through after he had nearly put me into the other studio, pushing me, holding me up. He's hit me right there as well in the heart, and I've gone back, and then suddenly he's took... Gaffer, he's gone, sorry. He's realised what he's done. But, I mean, that's what football does to you. You know, my kids, within seconds, that went viral or something. I mean, I'm useless and all this stuff. But and they're going, Dad, what are you doing? You
calm
know,
down, calm down.
Me. Calm down. But that's what football does to you. You know, Spurs have been in my blood since I was 8 years of age. And to think that I was still alive to see him reach the Champions League was after what happened was crazy. But it was a fantastic reaction when we look back at it now. But he does hold players. I could see how no one scored against him at a corner.
Do you know what? I was talking about Spurs. You came through Spurs, and we can go over all the history of everything, which is great. But I think a lot of the people that we see in the comments want to know about England and when you managed England as well.
Mm. I got a question for Joel first. Do you remember him as a player?
Not really. Let me tell you, this is what I've heard before you describe him. This is what I've heard. I'll be honest with you. Like, he's one of the key household names that you hear when you hear about England. You hear about Lineker. Again, I was too young to really watch Lineker at his best. Yourself, you're there. Obviously, we hear about Kevin Keegan as well. Mm. And
Brian Robson.
All those players. Like, so for me, we just know that there's a respect level there. I've met some of the players that you've coached. I've heard that you were such a good coach that sometimes the players would struggle when it comes to free kicks and stuff like that, because technically, you're just sound. You know, so it's true. That's what I'm hearing.
So I had to ask him, because I didn't think he would. I don't remember your Spurs, your Monaco days, but I do remember you at Chelsea. Mm. And then obviously my main memory, and I think a lot of our audience is a similar age to me and Joel, isn't it?
I'm younger than you, mate. We're not the same age.
Is obviously as you as England manager, predominantly. Yeah. Do you remember much of him as a player?
Yeah, I remember him definitely at Swindon and Chelsea. Mm-hmm.
But Spurs?
Spurs, I was more videos.
Yeah.
And I watched a lot of videos. Any videos that were out, I had, or my mates had. So I
for a modern comparison, what are you saying?
So this is one of the questions I had on there. Like, modern comparison.
Because I watched Jack Grealish.
No.
More goals.
Glenn Hoddle wasn't a runner with the ball as much. He was a passer. He could open it up and get a yard and then play a ball that no one else can play. Okay. Who would you most liken yourself to in the modern game?
It's a tough one, because it's very hard to answer that yourself. I saw pictures. I saw quick pictures like De Bruyne, if you like. You know, like Cancelo today. We saw some of the passes with the outside. I don't want to sound big-headed, but I just tell you the truth, and as it was, when I was 5 or 6, I left foot, right foot, didn't matter to me. It was just natural playing left foot or right foot. And then you still put the hard yards in, because I love football so much. I used to train. I was football nuts, like we all were.
What would you say, sorry, I know I'm cutting into you here, but what was it, one thing when you was young growing up, that helped you with the ball, with your passing, with your touch? If you could put it into young players now, what would it be?
See that there, that wall? A brick wall.
Yeah.
I went to Tottenham's lovely new, the training ground, when it was millions of pounds spent on it. It is fantastic. I don't know if you've been there.
Yeah,
really.
Yeah.
It's marvellous, isn't it? I remember I got the tour, and I said to the fella, it's lovely. I said, where's the walls? Where have you got your walls out? And he went, walls? I said, yeah, where's your wall? He went, well, we got the gym inside. I said, yeah, but outside, you got no walls. And he looked at me as if I was on another planet. That's how I got brought up. Every Tuesday and Thursday night sessions for Tottenham from 11 to 15 were in a ball court against the wall. It was squares, circles, lines to hit. That was what we did. Mm. Inside of the foot, outside the foot, volleys, half volleys, chest skills. That's how I got brought up.
The ball coming back to you all the time. We get loads of touches.
Yeah.
That's Berbatov's thing, isn't it?
Berbatov says that, yeah.
Did he?
Yeah, he's got a nice touch as well.
Yeah, honestly, you don't need a coach. You don't need your father. All you need is a ball and time. And if you put in the time yourself, you could be there hours. I was there hours at home. I'd come home from training. Next day, I'd be out in the garages doing it against the wall, out in the garages. And it was a wall, you know. I was mad. I'd come in and it'd be a sponge ball against the wall in my bedroom. Mm. You know, before I went to bed, I was obsessed with football, you know. But
come on, Glenn, give us that player. The current player who most reminds you of yourself. De Bruyne, could be. I think you was more, you had more of a silky, like you was an artist. Mm. You was trying, like the Cancelo ball today, outside of the boot, the one he set up for Sterling the other day.
Yeah.
That you was trying balls like that all day long.
Yeah, that felt natural to me. It was, if the ball was in the centre of my body, and you know, like in top level, whatever levels you're playing at, it's never always set sometimes. So rather than try and get wrecked, I just used to hit it with the outside of my left foot.
I'm saying. That's a different...
The audacity.
Or outside the right foot. Yeah. But what it does, what Cancelo does as well with his right foot, he doesn't do it with his left, but what it does is if you've got a ball, you find new angles that people don't think you can find. Mm. I think that's what hitting the ball with the outside of your foot is. Suddenly it's like you're 20 yards over there, and you're going to put it on the back of a fullback. Well, suddenly, if you can create that angle, it hits that line eventually with your outside, your right foot, and it goes back on that line as if you were 20 yards away. That's the beauty of hitting a ball with the outside of your foot. And it's a bit like a golfer, you know, when they can fade it and they can draw it. Exactly what I used to try and do with the football. Stevie Perriman said to me one day, he wrote in his book, he said, Glenn, he said, I played 13 years with him. He said his feet were like a set of golf clubs. He said they were literally like a set of golf clubs, so I could put backspin on it or I could put side spin on it. That's how I played. But it wasn't flash, it was just natural. Because I hit against the wall, I felt comfortable doing that.
But I saw that in England training. We went to England training. I'm a young player coming to England and I'm ringing my mates at home going, guys, and they're going, who's the best player? Guys, the manager.
The gaffer.
The manager's the best player in training. It's crazy. And he was doing things like kicking the ball. And I've asked you this before. He used to kick the ball and make noises. I just think this guy, he's seeing the ball and the game different. Wow. Like he's here sitting here talking like this to you guys. I can see you lot going,
Do you realise how quiet it just went?
Yeah, that's why I love it. When we're in the studio, every player, no matter how big you are in that studio, when Glenn starts to chat about things like the technical element of the game, it's like, give him the space.
It's when he did the tactical show with you, you know, the one that you do at BT.
Yeah.
With England.
England
squad.
I just sat there and I was, sorry, I hear you every week, right? But I just thought, this is amazing. I mean, we've heard the
pretty
legends.
Sure Glenn picked the same team I did, by the way.
It's good. But look, you said left foot, right foot from the age of 6 years old. You joined Spurs at the age of 12, right? Do you get there and think, no, even at that young age, that you're a special player?
I knew I was always playing above my age group, which is natural nowadays if you're going to be a good player. But back in the day then, there wasn't like under eights and nines. And you had to be, to go training at a professional club, you had to be 14 or 15 to sign schoolboy forms. So when I was going at 11 and a half, I'm playing against the 15-year-olds. Wow. So that's where our training was. There was me and Andy King. Do you remember, bless him, Andy King? He's passed away now. Great player. Everton, played at Everton. Very good player. So we were the same age. We were the younger ones. And we used to train with them like on a Tuesday and Thursday for 5 years, going down to Tottenham on my own on a train from Harlow. You couldn't do it now. Your parents wouldn't allow you to do it. You know, you just couldn't. The things I saw, you can imagine what I saw from punch-ups and stabbings and all sorts of stuff as a young kid. But that's, you know, I went through them hard yards. You know, you go through it because you want to be a footballer. But no, it was going there. And I knew I was holding my own with these people, with these guys that were much stronger and 3 or 4 years older than me and smashing you up against the wall because it was all indoors in this gym. And physically, I thought, hey, hang on a minute, it's not just about technique. That's when I thought to myself, I've got to meet fire with fire here as well. It's not just about going to be a good player with the ball and whatever. If you're going to be a pro, you've got to be mentally strong, you've got to be physically stand up for yourself and be brave. And that taught me a lot, that period of time from sort of 12 to 15 of the other side of the game, you know. So, and then when I was 15, I went into the men's league and played in the men's with my dad, funny enough. My dad was a good footballer. So I had a year of playing with my father in the men's league. And you can imagine, couldn't you, a little 15-year-old going past, getting kicked to lumps out of you, you know, and getting threatened that they're going to, you know, break your leg and things like
that. When you got into the first team, fast forward to the first team when you make your day and you start training with the first team, were the first team, did they receive you well? Or was you seen as a threat? Because I remember back in the day, sometimes young players could be seen as threats for the older players and it'd make it difficult for them.
I think there was that, Rio. It was a hard school, what I call hard school. When I went into the first team at 16 to train with them, Bill Nick was manager actually then, it was a tough school. It was like your Joe Kinnears and Cyril Knowles's. They were tough, hardened pros, you know. And you had to either, you know, you either drowned or you had to swim strong against the tide because they weren't going to make it easy for you. It's simple as that.
Different to now.
Yeah, it was quite harsh, actually. Very harsh.
Did you feel that?
I didn't. I think I always look at it. Me and Frank came through at the same time. And Frank's dad was the coach. His uncle was the manager. So inevitably, that made it more difficult for him. People were looking at him a bit more through his own ear because of them. So Frank had a tougher time with me convincing people that he was meant to be there on merit rather than just because it's his family kind of bringing him in. Whereas for me, it was easier for me in that sense. I went over, then it's all just about, are you good enough or are you not? There was no other story that was added to it.
Yeah,
so Frank, that's why Frank became very hardened and very strong mentally. He had to be strong mentally. So for me, no, it was fine. But I saw it with a lot of players that come over.
Mm.
Senior players would look and go, oh, that left back's come over. He's not meant to be a good player.
Yeah.
I will make it difficult for him. And you'd see senior players wouldn't talk to some young players at times. You think, wow. Just, but nowadays, it's such a more softer approach. And the first team players are very receptive and they bring the young players in, look after them a lot more. Yeah. So the transition's easier.
I remember going over one of my early sessions and I remember getting, it was almost like, they'd heard that I'd played well in the reserves. Some of them had played with me in the reserves and then the youth team for a year or two. And then suddenly I went over to the... And it, instead of like embracing it, it was like, oh, here comes the super kid.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, wow.
And it was like...
Banter.
And I'm thinking, what are they talking about? Oh, they're talking about me. But that put... Yeah, it was banter, but it was a bit of pressure on you as well. It was like, they were saying, oh, this is the super kid we've heard about and all this, like... And it was, I saw a resentment in some ways of some of the midfield players, particularly because I was a midfield player.
A starting 11 and that's it.
Yeah, it was back in the day. It was a much smaller squad. Yeah, and to break.
Literally kicking about the team. Yeah, and that's that.
Exactly. You, to break in was tough. But
who was the hardest player you played against? Who was your toughest opponent? Or the best player you played against? Obviously.
God, yeah, that's a good question. The best player I've ever played against was Maradona, without a doubt. But the toughest is if it's it.
Souness, is he in there?
Souness was bordering on tough come dirty.
I'm legally obligated.
No, he'd be the, if he was sitting here, he'd laugh because Graham was a hard player, tough, a good player. Mm. Don't get me wrong. People always say about his toughness and he was bordering on, you know, he could go look after himself, let's put it that way. Mm. But he was a good player. He could use the ball. Very good player. Great player.
I think so, I have to ask about Brian Robson.
So yeah, Robbo.
I was going to say, who's the best midfielder of your generation? Does Robbo come into that?
Yeah, Robbo for me always, I was suited really to continental football. I knew that as a kid. Coming through, I was going to have to fight against the tide. I think Robbo was made for British football, English football. Mm. He was box to box. He had a little bit of everything. He had stamina. He had a little bit of pace. He could defend. You know, he could get in the box and score goals. He picked a pass as well. He had a little bit of everything, which in them days, back then, it's different to today. Mm-hmm. You know, Robbo could play in any era because he was that good. But it was more looked upon in it, 4-4-2, box-to-box, midfield, and that's how it was back in the day. There wasn't a number 10 position, and I was a number 10, never really played there until I went to Monaco. As soon as I got to Monaco with Arsene Wenger, there was a position in France, and it was the most important position to the team. Mm. That's the key. There wasn't a position in England. Mm. We've got loads of 10s now, haven't we?
Where did they play in England then? Did you play as one of the 8s? A lot of them.
No, we didn't have an 8. I would like to have played in even an 8, but I played out on the right-hand side, on the wing, really. There was better wingers than me. Trevor Stephen, Stevie Coppell were. Mm. If you wanted to play a wide man, they sort of tried to fix me into the team in many ways.
Did you feel?
I played a few times with Robbo in the centre and midfield, and I felt that. I remember Ron Atkinson trying to buy me for Man United. And he thought me and Robbo would be perfect. And I remember sitting down with him, talking to him, chatting to him. I'm very close to coming. And I think, you know, that would have been interesting. But in the end, I stayed at Tottenham and for 13 years. But I could see what he was saying. He saw that as a real good balance between the two of us. Mm. And I think it would have been. And at club level, I think we could have took it on even more. But Robbo was a great player. Yeah, fabulous.
So Robbo?
Yeah,
great. Souness.
Soon as no, the toughest player is somebody that you wouldn't know. Gentile was tough, Italian.
Italian.
There was this one player, Schlurp, his name was.
Schlurp.
And he tried to kill me in the first leg in a European game. He played for Bohemian Prague he played for, and we drew against them. And we're at home first. He's trying to kill me. And I realised this after about the first 10 minutes. He's man for man marking me. He is trying to kill me. So I'm thinking, Glenn, you got to stand fire for fire here. I've got to look after myself. So not being that sort of player myself, but I'm thinking, so I try and do him. There's a 50-50. I know it's a little bit advantage to me, but I'm thinking this is my chance. I've got on the top of the ball and I might catch him. Well, I miss the ball completely and go straight down my own shins, into my own ankle. So I'm hobbling around thinking, well, that ain't going to work because I know I can't do that. Anyway, I get through the game. We win 1-0, and over there, he's now trying to kill me again. It's a terrible ground. It's terrible floodlights. Dreadful night. And for the first 20 minutes, he's kicking lumps out of me. And I remember, I looked round and he wasn't there. And I remember Ray Clements took the ball, bless him. And he took the ball and I'm straight on with him. So I'm straight on and I'm thinking, so I'm shouting, Clem, Clem, give me a call. I'm thinking, for some reason, I'm on my own first time. So as this ball's going, like, Garth Crooks is centre forward behind me and he's screaming at me, Hod, Hod, he's coming. And I'm thinking, oh God, and I think he's coming from the right side. So I flick this ball and the outside of my foot took up like as if it's going to go to Garth and I spin him. I think I'll mug him off, flick him that way, spin him here. I got it wrong. He was coming from the left, wasn't he? Oh, so no. I flick it. Rio, I get smacked. He's 26 stitches here. He tore my groin. My groin went. I was out for about 4 weeks. And he was
dirty.
Evil.
You needed wing mirrors then, yeah. You didn't have your wing mirrors.
I needed reverse.
Yeah.
Oh, I'll tell you what. His job was just to stop me from playing. So he was the one that I look back and think, yeah, Mr. Schlurp, his name was, and he stayed in my mind.
The number 10 role's gone now, isn't it? You talk about number 10 role. You've got the inside forwards now, you've got three up front, but the actual, remember the number 10s, the Del Pieros, the Baggios, the Bergkamps almost, the Zolas.
Platini.
That 10 role's kind of gone.
It's interesting. Yeah, they're semi-10s now. Mm. There's two 10s in a way. And, you know, you can either have two 8s in a deeper midfield or you play with a 2 in there and there's two half 10s. Back in the day, I've always looked at 10. The 10 is a really interesting position because there's three different ways that you could, styles that you play the 10. You've got a 10 like maybe, I don't know, a Dele Alli or a David Platt who would be a box runner. Man, or gets in the box, doesn't really look for build-up, get it wide, in the box, wait for movement, hit the spaces and score goals.
It's a bit like Bruno as well.
A little bit like Bruno, although he's got a little bit more.
You've got
that type of player as a 10, or you've got the semi-striker 10, the Zolas, the Bergkamps, the Cantonars, the Sheringhams. Mm. They're forwards that become 10s and can play as a 10. Scholesy does the same. Sensational player, Paul. And then you've what I call is, in my sort of position really, is your creative tens, your Platini 10 or your Zidane 10.
Savicevic.
You know, those type of players that can pull the strings, create and score goals, and as a midfield 10 rather than a striker 10, you know? So there's three facets to the 10 position. I played in an era really for 10 years in England. There wasn't a position like that for us. Mm. It was 4-4-2 or, you know, semi-diamond we played at Tottenham, but Ricky Villa played in the 10 position actually. So it's interesting, the number 10. You could do a whole program. I nearly wrote a book about number 10s actually.
Please do. Please do.
I've just finished one. So.
You mentioned Paul Scholes there, and I'm jumping from subject.
I was going to say, be careful, right? Yeah. Because we've got to talk about his playing days, and then we'll go on to England.
Yeah, I'm playing.
We're going to do it.
I can't help it. But you mention his name, I'm going straight in now. Don't care. Paul Scholes, Frank Lampard, Steven Gerrard. Who'd you take?
I'd play all three of them.
I know you would.
No, I didn't get the chance to coach Lamps or Stevie G. Worked with them with BT, which was lovely. Fabulous players. Obviously worked with Paul. And if people ask me who's the best player I've coached, and it's Paul Scholes.
Wow.
I always say Paul Scholes.
Wow.
He could play as a second striker. He could play behind the front. He ends up playing his career as a deep line midfield player. You could play Paul
anywhere.
And he would affect the game. Most effective. People say to me, Tiz was a fabulous footballer.
Matt Letizia.
Yeah. Incredible skills, fantastic for Southampton. And people just say, why didn't you play him more for England? And I used to go, Paul Scholes. So my answer is always Paul Scholes, because Paul could play that position, score goals, but do so much other things as well. But he was, you know, he was so easy to work with as well, Paul. You know, you just tell him one thing, it went in, he did it. He trained, and that was it.
So why did he not get his plaudits closer to the end of his career? Because I could see you liked him. If you take it back to World Cup 98, you were starting him. Do you know what I mean? Like, you could see that he had it there. Why do you reckon he didn't get as appreciated till the end, in my opinion?
Well, I appreciated him. I think a lot of people appreciated Paul Scholes. You played with him. Rio, we played with the man, so he would know him inside out. For me, he only had one weakness, and that could have been put right quite easily. I remember saying to him as a coach, saying, stay on your feet. He used to see the red mist a little bit, didn't he, Paul, and get booked and sent off quite a few times. I remember him getting sent off the game after I came out of England was against Poland, I think. And I was watching telly and he goes flying. I'm thinking, stay on your feet, Paul. It was the only thing that for me was a blemish on his performances. So I think a lot of people appreciated him. But he could play so many positions and affect the game. Football's about affecting the game, whether you've got ability, whether you're good in the air, whether you're a good tackler. It doesn't matter, you've got to affect the game. It's not, you know, anyone goes wants to just perform skills or do anything, go to the circus and watch that. You know, football is about a team game and it's about a winning mentality. You've got to affect the game in a positive way and do the right thing at the right time. And sometimes I look at players and they abuse their ability. They abuse football.
Okay, what do you mean?
Well, I think they take advantage of their own ability. I never did that as a player. I always put the game first in my mind.
I'm thinking he's thinking about Neymar.
Who, sorry?
Neymar,
definitely one.
That's the first name that's sprung to my head.
Definitely, there's a lot of players like that I look at and I think you're playing for yourself here, not your team. And people get carried away and they YouTube them and this skill and that skill. Great. End product. What do they do at the end? At the end of that skill.
Neymar always got end product, though.
What were they trying to do? Things he doesn't end up with the end product where he could have, somebody else was in a better position, really, in my opinion. And there's been a lot of players like that I call abusing the game because of the abilities. So you've got to be in control, even if you're a creative player. You've got to control that. Not once did I ever see Bergkamp or Zola, for instance, abuse the game. It was all in product at the end of the day, you know?
AS Monaco, playing under
Arsene,
one of the best managers, if not the best manager of all time.
Says the goon.
Yeah. What was that like?
It was everything I hoped for when I went abroad. As I've been explaining, I explained that in my book more. I didn't have this position, but within 1 week, Arsene said to me, oh, well, you're our number 10. So I went, didn't have a number 10 anymore. And so he explained what he wanted from me. Within the first half of our first, we played Red Star Belgrade in a friendly, pre-season friendly. I remember coming in at half-time and Arsene saying to me, Glenn, you're coming too deep. And I went,
what formation are you playing at this time?
Well, he played, this is the thing, he played similar to how people play now. Mark Hateley was the other foreigner at the time, me and Mark. Mark would be the centre forward and I was just behind in the 10. And then he had a wide left winger. And then he had a three, similar to, absolutely the same system as when he first went to Arsenal. Changed the back a little bit. The back, they had a squarer back four. He had a man marker at the back and a sweeper. But in the midfield, he had two holding players like that. Myself in front and a striker. George Weir eventually comes and plays at Monaco as well. And had a wide winger like he did with Overmars. And he had a player that tucked in with these two and would break out wide, just like Ray Parlour did, actually, at the time for Arsenal. And other players like Perez did. And so this template that he'd put together with Monaco was replicated when he came to Arsenal. They had Vieira and Petit in there, two fabulous players. And he had those two holding players always, but then he had the number 10. And I think when he went to Arsenal, I think Bruce Rioch had bought Bergkamp. So he already had his number 10. He had Wrighty up front, and he had whoever eventually brings Thierry Henry. So, you know, it was a similar thing at Monaco, but it was great to hear you're coming back too deep. I still want you to defend, but defend up there behind Mark. Organise the front players and defend from there, which at the time I was 28, I understood the game by then, you know. I think that's the great thing Rio would understand as well as a defender even more. When you play and people say about experience, in football, it's like when you're a kid, you've got this set of curtains that open, and you think the game is about what you're seeing and what you're experiencing. Suddenly, you hit 24, 25, and there's another set of curtains open, and then when you get to 29, 30, there's another set of curtains open when the game becomes so much easier. You read everything what's going to happen before it happens. You can put people into positions before it happens. Your game becomes easier. your legs start to go a little bit. That's the problem. So it's a bit of a conundrum. And you know what? I was lucky enough to go into player management. So for me, at 34, 35, 36, I played till I was 38, there was even another set of curtains opened for me.
You see all the pictures, don't you, then?
Yeah, it was, the game become, without sounding, it's not arrogant, it became easy. Because you know your legs were going a bit. You couldn't quite do what you used to be able to do physically, getting around and training. But the game became so much easier when these curtains and the reading of the game and understanding of the game. And you just wished you had a pill that could take you till you were 50 and keep opening these curtains. But obviously, it doesn't happen like that.
Listen, the playing career was fabulous. You went into management. And you've done obviously fabulous things there. I know I keep being selfish and bringing it back to myself and the England squad that I was involved in. And you made it fun. It's probably the most enjoyable time I had when I was with England. And a lot of that was to do with skill-based warm-ups. And I remember some players, like Michael Owen was one of them, used to go, oh, no, he's doing this again. Because he didn't want to do skill stuff. Some people just didn't want to do it.
Yeah.
I loved it. But yeah. Was there a reason behind me? Because some of your training was really based around the match.
Yeah.
And your opponent exploiting their weakness, like we spoke about earlier. But in the beginning of it was very much fun. What was the thought process for all the coaches watching going into sessions?
Well, it was difficult. It was difficult when that was the change from a club being a club manager to having time. You had to get on with the stuff you needed to, what I call the serious stuff of getting what was going to, you know, your opponents, you knew how they were going to play, you knew how you wanted to play, there were certain things in a game that were going to happen and you wanted to demand that and get clarification for your team. So that was what I call the basic serious side about building for that match. And that's what happened with England, you know, it's all quiet and then suddenly when England come together, it's like a volcano waiting to go off again. You don't really take any consideration about a volcano until it actually explodes, and that's like getting together with England was like that. It was so massive, everyone's eyes and press and everything for that week was bang, and that's what it is like for Gareth now. But I felt that we had limited time, but I felt you needed to break that down. And for me, being a technical player, not so much a player, but with a technical eye, I needed my. I as an England player. Was fed up with chasing opponents in midfield. We were outnumbered in midfield, and when we got the ball, we didn't have enough because we were too rigid in our system. So I said to myself, if I ever got that job, which I didn't set out to get, but if I ever got the England job, the one thing I will do is I'm going to fill that midfield up. That's where I think you win and lose games, in particularly in international football. And that's why we played three at the back. And that's why we had wing backs and we had different combinations and styles. We played in Le Tournoi and won that Le Tournoi before the World Cup, playing with two little inside forwards and one striker, which people are playing now with wing backs. And we played some beautiful football. But I think if you can't ask your team to do that, I needed to know which players could cope with the technical side of the game. We're international footballers. We should be able to cope with the football. You know, at the end of the day, it's called football, not headball, not chase ball.
But in their warm-up, some people couldn't.
Well, that's it. But they had to improve.
Serious.
They had to
improve.
Like who? Yeah, I'm like who?
Glenn's got a better memory than me.
Yeah.
Bottled
but you could, very quickly, you could see the lads that were like, you know. Mm. But Michael Owen, for instance, wouldn't have. Gary Lineker hated stuff like that. He was one of our greatest strikers, like Michael was. We were talking about Michael today. What a striker. And he knew his job was like his pace, score goals. He wasn't too interested. But even Michael, if he works at his left foot, you can all improve. And if you don't put them sessions on, you'll never improve. Because then you can go and do that against a brick wall when you're 11. But when you're in the England camp, you got to do it in a match. It's got to be something that you're improving to actually at the top level. So unless you practice it, unless you feel comfortable with it, you're never going to improve. And if you don't feel comfortable with it, you're never going to use it in a game anyway. But you won't know until you're put under that test, under that little bit of pressure, because you have to produce them skills, as I say, when you need them out there on the pitch in a pressurised situation.
You brought his name into the conversation again, Michael Owen. For all the people that watch this show, who probably some of them might be a bit young to remember and appreciate, you managed Michael Owen prime time. Can you just enlighten us to what What level? And in today's game, does he sit amongst 18 years old, amongst, I don't know, the next generation coming through of a Haaland and Mbappe?
Yeah, without a doubt. Without a doubt. When I saw Michael at 17, well, I saw him actually in the youth team first, but I saw him at 16, 17, and his movement and his pace. I've coached and played with so many players that have got pace and they don't know how to use their pace. They've gone, you know, the offside rule was changed, obviously, for the better now, but he had to play in the era when the offside was different. But they didn't know quite how to use their pace, the timing of their runs. Well, Michael had both. You know, you had to defend against him.
Mm.
So you would know out there on the pitch what it would be like marking him. He was so clever in his movement, and then he had the pace as well.
He made runs, and he positioned himself like he was lacking a yard of pace, like he was slow.
Yeah.
So he would play really close on the edge of the shoulder, on the edge of being offside, and make the timing was unbelievable, like he was slow. Like Glenn said, the quick players would probably react to the ball being played and go, I'm quick enough to get there and I'll get there in the end. He ran before the ball was played, anticipating. Yeah.
Rio, you said that you struggled sometimes. You needed reinforcements when he knew he was coming up against Owen because he was just that quick.
Yeah, 1v1.
Him and Anelka, you said the ones.
Yeah, him and Anelka were the top young ones when we were growing up, definitely.
Anelka, that's interesting, yeah.
But you'd put someone like Michael Owen in his prime.
Right,
if you put him right now with Mbappe and...
He could score goals like we all saw him score at the Argentina goal. Yeah. What a way to, you know, what a way to, you know, pronounce yourself to the world, really. Mm. So he had that sort of goal in him. He had the ones where he's through on goals because of his movement. But he was a fox in the box as well. He could score in that six-yard box. A ball drops down. Who's there? Oh, Michael's there again. Bang, it's in the back of the net before you knew it. Mm. So he had that instinct and he had the movement. And when, you know, if you wanted to defend high against him, he'd have a field day.
Yeah.
He'd actually have a field day against his own team at the moment, Liverpool. Mm. You know, I know he's played for a lot of other, but the way they defend, you'd struggle to defend that way with Michael Owen playing against you because he'd be in it forever. He'd be in all the time. So he was a wonderful player and a great lad, a very intelligent player. If you cast your mind back to the 98 World Cup when we had Bex got sent off, normally a coach would bring off one striker and play 4-4-1, and it would be Shearer you keep on, your captain and your experienced player. Well, I thought, you know what, I want Shearer up there, but then I want Michael up there a little bit. But I would have had to take Michael off if he couldn't cope with playing right side of midfield of a four for any period. So we sort of changed them, 5 minute little dovetailed them, you know, Michael's pace, then Alan's strength and his goal scoring ability and respect. I didn't want Michael off the pitch if we could help it. And he was so intelligent the way he defended. Because if he couldn't track back, you know, we're down to 10 men, they were going to overload us. He had to stay with the fullback. He had to do his defensive duties when it was his spell out there. I knew Alan could do it because of his experience. And then we'd swap him and give him a little bit of a release up there for 5 minutes, 6 minutes, and then swap him again. And he was absolutely brilliant. I couldn't believe how he did that job.
So, wasn't it?
Oh my God. It was a hell of a game. Yeah.
Did you know that, looking at him through training, did you know that he was going to be impactful during the tournament at some point?
Oh, yeah. No, we...
He'd done enough in training.
Really?
Seriously.
Yeah.
He hurt a few people in training.
Sounds like someone absolutely taken.
Well, he was a kid at the time as well, though.
Yeah, I was the same. We were the same age.
He was a kid at the time. But no, he was always... We had him earmarked. Whatever was going to happen before, we didn't know. But he was 100%. I don't care. I mean, Teddy was a completely different player to Michael. And Teddy and Shearer had played so well in 96 together. They knew that. But I knew against Colombia... You know, we'd been watching tape after tape. We'd watched them play, and they played so high to the halfway line. I said, I don't care if Teddy scores a hat trick the day before or the game before. Sorry, Michael's got to play in that game because of his pace and the way they defended. Mm. So he was always going to start, but obviously we put him on, and he scores against Romania anyway. Although we lost the game, but he was always going to play. Oh, without a doubt, I was going to put him in there with his pace. And the only thing we had to work at, we did, I remember having a little bit of, I needed him to, and funny enough for his goal, he drops in. We had to drop him in at times. Well, I didn't want the two strikers up there square, making it easy for international defenders to mark. Like we'd played, in my era, we'd played two square. And obviously Teddy would drop in with Alan Shearer. So I thought, well, there's time. I want to dovetail them. So Alan would drop in at times and Michael would be off the shoulder. And I wondered if he was intelligent enough to drop in and would keep Alan up the top there. So we had this combination. And if you remember the goal, he drops in beautifully. Mm. And Bex plays a little ball into midfield and he gets turned. On. He gets turned and runs at you with his pace. Mm. So if it was pacing behind, it was going to hurt you. But if he could come off, and he was that intelligent, he knew when to come off and get turned and run up with you with the ball, which was his goal. You know, that was the template for his goal. It was amazing.
I keep throwing names at you. So comparisons. Rooney, prime time. Owen, prime time. Alan Shearer, prime time. God. Which one are you taking?
That's impossible.
The fans want to know.
Oh, that's impossible. I didn't work with Rooney, obviously. Would have loved to. So it's only looking from afar. Wow. That is so, so tough.
Could he be more different as well than three?
Yeah,
but that's true, actually.
Why are you giving him a way out?
Yeah. It's hard to go against Shearer, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Wow. It's hard because he had everything that you wanted in a centre forward, actually. Of course, we've just said what Michael's strengths were, and I'm not sure defenders would want to play against Shearer week in and week out. They wouldn't want to play against Michael's pace, but there were games where you perhaps could dominate him because of his physical size. Well, you couldn't do that with Shearer. Mm. Shearer was deceptively quick and knew how to get on the shoulder, in the air, put crosses in, you knew you're in trouble. He could score close into the goal. He could score 30-yard strikes as well.
League all-time scorer as well.
Sorry?
Premier League all-time scorer.
Yeah, yeah. So I would actually say Shearer. If I had to pick one team, and I think I'd go Shearer.
Wow. It sounds like Rooney's a combination of the both of them.
Yeah, yeah, he is. So. Funny enough, it's a good observation. Wow. I never worked with Wayne, and he looks, from the outside looking in, he looks a fabulous, he was a fabulous player, and he would have looked great to have worked with. But I just think he had other attributes. I don't think you could play Alan Shearer like Rooney plays, as it played deeper and stuff like that. You know, he had that to his bow. But Alan, if you're talking about a one-off number nine striker who could, you know, he didn't go abroad, but even abroad I think he'd have scored a bag full of goals abroad as well. So I'd just say Alan. Mm. Only by a short head.
We didn't have this as a question, but I think we should have it. Who's the best centre-half? You don't need to say him.
Well, talking about centre-half, this is I've said this to him and I've gone public and said it. I say it in my book. That's one of the frustrations of losing the England job at the time when I did. I played three at the back when I went into my first management at Swindon, let alone when I went to Chelsea, I tried it. But with England, we played three at the back. This man here, we didn't even see, he was a wonderful, wonderful footballing centre half, but we still didn't see where we could have taken him with a three at the back. Mm. He could have gone on and been... people would have seen him as his ability so much more. In a back four, it was very difficult. Even at a great side with Man United, you know what I'm saying? You couldn't go and play and go into midfield because you couldn't leave your mate on his own. And the fullbacks, that was their job to go. But in a three, with him playing in the centre of a three, we only had the one. My last game for England, he played in the middle of a three at Wembley. He was sensational. Wow. I wanted him to go into midfield with the ball or without the ball at times. I had Paul Ince that would drop in for him if we felt it was going to break down. Rio would have took us to another level playing three at the back.
Would you have him central or one
central,
wide ones?
Central. At that time, central. Maybe there was times in games if they played one up, I'd have put him on the right-hand side. Mm-hmm. Because with one up, you get out on the outside centre-backs. Mm. But back then, there was a lot of two strikers used to split. And he'd come through the middle. And he did it unbelievably as a young kid at Wembley against the Czech Republic, which was, you know, he just kept coming into midfield. And it just gives you an extra man in midfield. The Germans did it through my era of a player. They did it with Matthäus. Sama. They did it with Sammer. Going way, way back to Beckenbauer. Rio could have been... even better than what we saw with him. Great defender, and in a three, he wouldn't have had to go out so wide and defend as well. So that would have protected him a little bit, even more defending. So, but with the ball, that was the frustration. I had a plan with these four wonder kids. Mm. Michael Owen.
Owen, Rio.
Rio, Scholesy, and David Beckham. Wow. They're all 21, 22. Yeah. You guys were younger, you and Michael. And then we still had the likes of Shearer, Ince, Sheringham, Seaman, Tony Adams around. Yeah. We had experienced players still in their peak, you know? And any manager will tell you that's the template you're looking for. Experience and youth, but quality. Quality players. And that's what I felt more frustrated about, being taken away, not having that opportunity to take that team somewhere.
So it was a bit ahead of its time almost, wasn't it? Because I knew you wanted to have us play. Now, I can remember, I think it was Championship Manager 1998. One of the things on the back of it was the England team formation on the back of the box, I think. And it's the first time why is he three at the back? Mm-hmm. What is he doing? Because every graphic you ever saw for football formations, 4-4-2. Yeah. That's it.
It was a magazine after that one, I believe.
But what did you... It's all well and good you're saying he was a wonder kid. He says exactly the same thing that you said about you. He wishes that you were there longer. Mm. But talk me through his first training session, because am I correct you had brought him in when he was 17
to
come and watch the team?
When to train
as well.
He was one I earmarked. The thing was, I earmarked him. I knew I wanted to play three at the back. And I earmarked him to come in as soon as I could. If he was at a club, if I was a club manager, Rio would have been training with us every day. Mm. Whether he was ready yet for the first team, probably at 15 or 16, I'd have brought him in, which I did at club level, just to get the feel, just to be around the first team. Mm. But as an international manager, you don't get that opportunity. So it was about bringing him in a couple of sessions before that we could bring him in. And I earmarked him for this role, you know. And I had to look at him very sort of magnified, really, in training, in everything that he was doing. Could he cope with the possession? Could he cope with this? Could he cope with that? So it was keeping an eye on him at a young age, knowing where I wanted to take him for the future.
What did you see?
And how quickly could he get there? Mm-hmm. It's no good putting him in too early, and it's no good holding him back, you know, too long. But at club level, you know that pretty quickly. Here, it was a bit ducks and drakes. I had to look at it. And there was a few things I was tough on you on a couple of things that I knew that
I got done for drink driving.
Yeah,
I was younger.
And I'd come down on him in the right way. At the time, he probably hated me for it, but I was trying to make him, you know, see as a young man that he's got responsibility, and I always take everything back to the pitch. It always goes back to the pitch to me. So if you let yourself down and whatever, and I felt he did at that time for himself, we're not perfect, of course we're not. But I'm thinking, is he going to let you down on the pitch? If I've got a player that keeps being late for training, is he going to get late for a corner who he's got to pick up the number six?
I wasn't late for training, by the way. Just so you know.
No, I'm on about. I know a Chelsea player that we lost the semi final because it. But he was late getting back, and he didn't know who he was picking up. And I'm thinking, relate it back to the pitch. And that's how he was off the pitch. Mm. And that's how he was on the pitch. And I was always taking it back to football. So that was the lesson. I was trying to teach a lesson for him to make him a better player.
And a good man as well at the same time.
Mm. Yeah, well, listen, we all make mistakes, especially when we're a kid as well. Bloody hell, mistakes I made when I was 17, 18. But it was about, for me as a manager, it was about relating it to my footballer. The person and the footballer, the two different people. Two different things, but if there was an example there, then I don't care what age they were, it's about what was going to happen on the football pitch. So that was the idea of bringing Rio in and seeing whether he could cope all right. Mm-hmm. He coped, and it was great experience for him for when he does come into the team, he feels at home. Mm. It's not too much of like, oh, I'm walking, there's Alan Shearer there. You know, he got used to it a little bit, even if he wasn't playing at the time. And we took familiar. Him to the World Cup. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You rang his mates.
It's making you comfortable. It's making you feel as comfortable as you possibly can. Mm-hmm. And technically, I knew he was a technical player, so I knew he'd enjoy what we were trying to do.
Mm-hmm. So in today's fast forward now, you watch the England team now. Which young players in English football excite you most?
Oh,
and would you love to be
managing? That's an easy one. Phil Foden.
I knew he was going to say that.
Phil Foden, to me, without lumping too much pressure on him, I think he possibly could, if we play him right, if we do him the right thing with England, and I think the system, what Gareth's got, he's got a chance the way we're playing now. Mm. And he's at the right club as well with the right manager. in 3 years' time, I think we might have somebody who could be like, we haven't had a player since Bobby Charlton, probably, that was probably at the best, one of the best players in the world at that time in 66. This kid could be the best player, one of the best players in the world, if he keeps going. Mm. If he keeps playing and keeps, you know, if they win European Cups, Man City, if they go on from there and he gets that experience of playing in the Champions League week in and week out, international football, he can score goals, he can create, he understands the game. For me, he is a top, top player, and he will be, and he's not going to get any worse. Mm. He's going to get better and better. And I saw him at 17 when they won the Youth World Cup. And it was interesting. I'm rubbish on this, but very rarely do I do tweets. Every now and again, I do one off the cuff myself. And I was watching the game, and they're playing Chile. I think it was Chile they were playing. And I just looked at this kid. I hadn't seen him play before, and I thought, oh, my word, he's picking up all the positions. Look at the skill he tried there. Look at the passing. And I just went, this kid's more South American than the South Americans he's playing against. And people picked that up, you know. But it was just what I was seeing for the first time. And he's progressed. And we're all a bit worried that Pep was holding him back. And, and I thought, if you're not going to send him out on loan then, you know, let him grow. But to be fair, he's held him back for the right reasons. I think this kid could be very, very special. Because I think he's got the environment in England and the environment at his club around him that is perfect for his game, you know? Mm.
I can't believe Glenn just said no pressure but Bobby Charlton. Okay. Only a Ballon d'Or winning World Cup, European Cup champion. Sound.
Well, that's Bobby Charlton probably when he was Phil Foden's age was probably nowhere near that. Of course he wouldn't have been. So that's how things happen. And Bobby Charlton had a hard time. He was played out on the wing and, you know, these things. He had a hard time many years ago getting into the England team, even back then.
But granddad says that. He was a bit of a fringe player when he was left winger.
Yeah. It just shows you, doesn't it? You know, brought into the middle, played like he did. And for me, yeah, that's where we're going way, way back. I was just a kid watching, but we did have three world-class players there. Mm-hmm. A lot of players have been called world-class players in 66, which weren't world-class. They're only world-class because we won the World Cup. But the genuine were Bobby Moore, Gordon Banks, Bobby Moore and Bobby Charlton.
Spine of the team.
Yeah, those three were world-class.
I just want to keep it a little bit on Rio and other players as well, not just you, mate.
Yeah, take it off.
Yeah, no, not just you, not just you. You spoke about, within your documentary, desire, right? Yes, you spoke about the talented players that you played with, but who would you say has the most desire that you played with? Or played with and worked with at the same time?
I tell you what, the way I'll answer that, I think, is I played with players that, when I was younger, I looked at, one of them was older than me, who used to coach me, funny enough, and one was an AUP with me that I thought, well, they're never going to make it. But they did. And it was pure desire and character. And I learned a lot off them. I learned as much off them as I did watching, you know, players play when I was a kid watching for Tottenham or Bobby Charlton or George Best or whatever. It was the character side. They had a desire and a character to just bounce back and if crowds got on their back. That's another thing that people don't understand. When you're a youngster coming in, crowd, you give the ball away, the crowd will get on your back. And at the end of the day, you've got to sink or swim. But these players, Johnny Pratt was one that I watched as a player, and I used to give the ball away, and the crowd used to, 30,000, 40,000, would hammer him. It didn't matter. He just kept looking for the ball again. It was like water off a duck's back. And Paul Miller, centre-back, who was my mate, but, you know, was limited as a player. But they had a desire, a burning desire and ambition, and nothing was going to stop them. Nothing was going to stop them. They were going to make it, and they did, and they had fantastic careers. And I think I took a bit of that as well. About, you know, it wasn't just all the techniques and the players and the you needed the desire. And desire is another word for that inner pride. You got to have that inner pride. If a ball went under my foot in training, phew, it was like a knife going through my heart. That's the standard that I put myself in under. If I miscontrolled a ball that I knew I should have controlled, didn't happen many times, but no, joking apart, that would hurt. That would really hurt me. And I think I don't see enough of the players. And as a manager, I was always looking for that inner player, you know. And the best have all got that. All the best players. And when I went to England, that was evident. As a player and a manager, they were the ones that were their standards were that high every day that it would hurt their pride if they didn't do what they wanted to do to achieve, whether it was a skill or a tackle, whatever it was. That was the standard that they set themselves. So all them things come into being a footballer. There's so many players that have got talent that think talent's enough that they end up going by the wayside because talent isn't enough.
Mm. It really isn't. Think I could have asked for a better way to finish the interview. Yeah. Thank you very much, Glenn.
Pleasure. Great being with you, guys.
Really appreciate it. Insightful as ever.